There should not be even a system designed in the system to negate random genetic mutation whatsoever. Should not be
Absolutely.
Any error correction at all. Life should be built upon and absolutely love and incorporate as much random genetic mutation as possible. But that's quite the opposite. These utterly ingenious multiple layers of error correction that are built into the DNA support system and the DNA itself, utterly brilliant. I mean, they rival the best mathematics of man. The algorithms that perform these functions, they're absolutely ingenious. You look at the algorithm, they have attempted to reproduce some of these algorithms, man has. And what we find is that they're every bit as good, if not better, than ours. They're incorporating them now into computer software because they're so excellent. And so, that's true. But here's something about DNA. Evolutionists say that DNA develops from RNA. You know, it evolved from RNA. Well, that's not possible because of the properties of RNA. RNA, like DNA, conforms to linguistics law. It uses algorithms to store and retrieve information and modify information. It's a physical carrier for information, a representative of information. I've said this many times. A book is not the information, the text, the physical book, the text characters printed on page, that's not the book. The book exists in the mind of the author that wrote the book. The physical book is merely a representation of that information, a physical carrier to convey that information. DNA is the same way. DNA is genetic information which defines the structures and functions of an organism. That's information. Information is immaterial, that is, it's not tangible. It can be only, therefore, be a product of mind, of intelligence. And therefore, this proves also intelligent design and special creation, because the information existed first in the mind of a creator. The DNA molecule was created as a physical carrier for that information to represent it later. So you've got proof of intelligent design and special creation in DNA or RNA. See? So RNA could not come into being because of random genetic, random molecular interactions either, because it possesses properties only that can be held by intelligence, linguistics law, algorithms, and information. All three of those are immaterial, can only be produced by intelligence. They're products of mind. So you can take that RNA argument and just toss it right into the trash can, because RNA possesses properties that is not possible for the material world to produce, such as the immaterial processes of information, algorithms, and linguistics law. There you go.
Agreed.
Going back to the
error correction, any cell would not want error correction. Evolution would not want error correction. Why would it want to fix? It doesn't want to fix errors. It wants those errors to happen so it can compound upon itself.
Right.
So they might argue, well, but if it doesn't error correct, then it can't survive properly either. Well, now you're talking intelligence. Now, there is no intelligence within evolution. Evolution just happens. It's a process. It doesn't know that, well, I got to cut down on my mutations. I got to cut back on those chips, man. It's starting to put a lot of pounds on me. I got to cut back. I got to cut back on mutations. There's just too many right now.
Yeah, it had time to think about it and started realizing. Yeah.
I agree.
Absolutely. Yeah, error correction, it just blows. John, there are a lot of scientists, biologists, and geneticists in this world that espouse evolution. And they're sitting there in their laboratories, they're writing papers and studying this error correction process that they notice that they induce a change into the DNA, a mutation here at this point, and then they go back to the organism and extract DNA again, and they look at it and they say, it's been fixed. Why about that? It's been repaired. I'll be doggone. And they're writing these papers, and they've discerned several levels of this error correction, and there's got to be a light bulb going on in their head. Hey, pal. Hello in there. Hello, McFly. You know it's got to be nagging at their conscience, but they can't speak out against it.
Right.
They can't
speak
out against it because they'll lose their job, right?
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Here's something interesting. Ernst Mayr was one of the world's most prominent paleontologists. He said, paleontologists have long been aware of the seeming contradiction between Darwin's postulate of gradualism, confirmed by the work of popular population genetics, and the actual findings of paleontology. Following phylogenetic lines through time seem to reveal only minimal gradual changes, but no clear evidence for any change of species into a different genus for the gradual origin of the evolutionary novelty. Anything truly novel always seems to already appear quite abruptly in the fossil record. In other words, and there I can, here's one by Stephen Jay Gould. The history of the fossil, most fossil species includes two features particularly inconsistent with gradualism. One, stasis. Most species exhibit no gradual change during their tenure on the Earth. They appear in the fossil record looking much the same as they did when they appeared. Morphological change is usually limited and directionless. Actually, the truth is there is no morphological change. He's making an assumption there that one kind begat another. Okay, and two, he says, sudden appearance. In any location, species do not appear to arise gradually by the steady transformation of its ancestors. It appears all at once and fully formed. That was Stephen Jay Gould, who put forth punctuated equilibria idea, but he didn't invent it. He just kind of codified it, kind of like Charles Darwin did evolution theory. One of the most famous paleontologists in history from Harvard University, Stephen Jay Gould. These, I could provide you many, many such quotes of evolutionist scientists who say, are scratching their head saying, you know what, Charles Darwin's idea doesn't seem to be supported by the fossil record. Everything appears abruptly, fully formed, no transitional forms. We don't find them anywhere. What happened? How could evolution be true when all the fossils we dig up seem fully formed without predecessors? You know, so they put forth this punctuated equilibria idea that, well, since there's no evidence for it, that means it happened so fast it left no evidence of itself, which is really ridiculous because that is a jump right out of science into the world of fantasy and then claiming it's science. Right, how is it scientific to claim that it happened anyway? You know my little character I like to do? It happened anyway, man. You know, that's the thing here. It didn't happen in the fossils, therefore it happened anyway. That's what they're saying. That demonstrates that evolutionism is not scientific. It's not even science. It's the pushing of a dogma, a paradigm, and the refusal to acknowledge any of the tremendous number of scientific discoveries that have been made, which demonstrates intelligent design and special creation. And now we're seeing it in the cosmos, aren't we, John? Even the evidence that there was a flood on this earth, just like God's word says.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you can look at these papers. These peer-reviewed papers are actually full of, you know, I will not take it away. They're full of very useful information. The problem is, it's the way they interpret the data. That's the biggest difference. Right. We're looking at it from one aspect. They want to look at it from something completely different. So here you have, right, in the case, what we were talking about at the beginning of the show, you know, here we have terrestrial fossils on the moon. We have ice. We have ice, pure ice. In some of the craters, we have ice soil mixed with some of the other ones, on and on and on, blah, blah, blah. We've been over this already. And we look at the evidence and go, gee, that seems to match the flood. They look at the evidence and go, see, right, this is obviously proof that life came from a nebulous cloud 10 billion years ago someplace else, and then it was blasted to Earth from outer space someplace. Wait, what? Or wait, how do you get there? How do you get there? I don't know. Mm-hmm.
They're coming up with this idea, like Richard Dawkins is talking about, that life somehow could hop, skip, play hopscotch around the universe, right? But it couldn't have originated here. No. See, you know, Richard Dawkins said in an interview with Ben Stein, and in the movie, I forgot the name of it now. He was interviewed by Ben Stein, and he stated that he thought it was possible that life was created somewhere else and brought to the Earth by an intelligent life form, an alien life form somewhere else. He was not willing to believe that it could have arisen on the Earth, which is what evolutionists have been saying all along. I mean, he's not saying that he's not willing to believe it. He's saying that it doesn't seem as likely, in essence, is what he's saying. He's willing to believe that an alien intelligence somewhere else could have created life and put it on the Earth, but he's not willing to believe that the God of the Bible could have been that intelligence. You see, it had to be an alien from somewhere else. And he even went so far as to say that if that were the case, then that life form had to have evolved somewhere else. Well, do you see a contradiction here? Wait a minute. A life form evolved somewhere else, then brought life here. Life couldn't have evolved. Why didn't it evolve here? See, because they've pointed out, John, so many problems with abiogenesis. The Earth's environment doesn't have rank. Molecular interactions can't build something of ever-increasing in complexity. All these problems for abiogenesis, they see them, so they have to go outside of the Earth to look for the answer. And that's what Richard Dawkins is doing. But you see the contradiction there? The life form that brought Earth life to the Earth, it did, but it evolved on another world. Well, why didn't it just evolve here and skip that step altogether? See?
Right,
the hypocrisy
right.
of that? I mean, if you were to ask Richard Dawkins, well, how did life get seeded on that planet? He would have said, well, it either evolved there or maybe another alien life force brought it there. And you could say, well, it got there from another one. And then it would go further back and there was another one. And another one all the way as far back as they will do anything. They will step back as many steps as necessary from creation just to keep from acknowledging what science has revealed about life. You know, it's almost humorous, really.
Yep. I agree. Anyway, we can opine on, we can talk about that all day long, but you're right. There's so much evidence for creation within the peer-reviewed evidence within the journals, and the more I read, you know, a lot of these journals, the more I find. It's just all about the interpretation of the evidence, and they will never, ever,
right.
because they can't, but they will never, ever leave the paradigm. They will always make an inference back to a natural cause or a sort of a evolutionary type of a origin, because that's, well, basically what they're necessarily brainwashed to do. They can't look at it and say, well, wait a minute now, how could there be any other explanation for this? Is that possible? They claim that that's what they do, but then they don't do it. The evidence isn't there. It's like someone saying, oh yeah, I'm going to do that, but then they never do it, you know. It's the same scenario within the scientific community. Oh, yeah, we look at all theories. We look at all options. Well, no, you really don't. You look at your paradigm, and if it doesn't fit your paradigm, you dismiss it as, oh, well, they're not very smart. Or as some of the people are doing in my video, that's not really a peer-reviewed journal. Come on. That's not a real peer-reviewed journal.
All right. Right. Oh, and that creationist scientist, he's not a real scientist.
Oh, right. Yeah, exactly. Walt Brown is a great example. I had a long conversation with a gentleman who was like, well, it can't be legitimate because Walt Brown's never had that peer review. If it's actually accurate, how come it's not peer reviewed? Oh, good grief. Are you kidding me? This guy's been working on the theory since 1985. You don't think there might be a little bit of substance in there? I mean, could there be any...
Yeah.
speck of truth to anything he's saying he's been working on since 1985, and you're going to dispute that he doesn't know what he's talking about with a PhD from MIT? Well, of course they're going to. No, he's a moron. Oh, well, isn't that convenient for you to just go ahead and dismiss him? And because it isn't peer-reviewed, it isn't actually, it doesn't actually make sense. So one of the things I brought up to him, I said, well, then you know what? Apparently planes don't really fly, because I don't believe that Orville and Wilbur Wright actually had any of their stuff peer-reviewed. So hence, flight can't actually have ever happened with an airplane, because their work was never actually peer-reviewed. That makes it not legitimate. So, I don't know, we can go round and rounds with arguments like that. But yeah, there's a lot of evidence in the peer review. It's just in how you interpret the evidence, that's all. There's a really good paper, actually. There's a really good paper I just recently read that was peer-reviewed about a mathematician that sat down and logically figured out, hey, guess what? I have parents, and my parents have parents, and I'll bet that those parents probably had parents. So let's run a mathematical formula and see just how far back it would trace if we had 6 billion people in the world. So he did that, and guess what? As it turns out, if you run the numbers backwards, you come out with about, 3,000 to 5,000 years ago, if we could go back in time, there was a man and a woman who were the descendants to everybody living on the earth today.
Right.
Oh, well, isn't that interesting? Okay, so this guy's approach is, if we could go back 5,000 years, we could find a man and a woman who were, in fact, descendants of everybody that's alive today.